it reminds me in many ways of the history of our country when it comes to Christianity. Obviously, the majority of people professing Christians. But what about the cultural aspect in our country? See, our country was founded on liberty, freedom. Freedom of religion is one very important part, but there was more to just that, right? Freedom of the press, freedom of assembly. Freedom, liberty. And because we recognize that freedom and liberty comes from God, we have a blend, don't we? A lot of our patriotic songs are really songs about liberty and freedom, but we include God in them. There's a combination there. The Wall Street Journal, for example, every Christmas Eve edition in the editorial section for 60 years, and you can go online and read this for yourself now if you don't want to wait till Christmas Eve, has a republished editorial that is all about freedom, and it's all about Jesus. And the idea that when he came to earth, you know, Rome ruled and Caesar and all. And it's a really good editorial until they get to the very end when they take a quote of Paul's to the Galatians, which is all about us Christians not going under the law of Moses anymore, but to stay in the freedom where Christ has made us free, talking about the free grace of God. And the editorial equates it to political human freedom, which is not what Paul was writing about. So they missed the point at the end. But you see, it's the culture. When I was a kid, every house had Christmas lights on it, except one or two, and you knew those were Jewish families. They were the only ones. If you weren't Jewish, you had Christmas lights on your house. I don't believe everyone on the street was a born-again believer, but it was a cultural thing. And what about business? There was a time that businesses would not be open on Sundays. If you had a family business of yourself, you think you could get by without being a member of some local church? And depending on what part of the country, which church you were a member of was pretty important too. But you couldn't socialize and say, oh yeah, I don't go to church. No one would go visit your shop. No one would hire you. That's how it used to be. No more though. Yes, there are still some businesses that are not open on Sundays, but you know, just about any business that's not open on Sunday is also not open on Saturday usually. In other words, they just closed for the weekend. It's not because of anything special for Jesus. And we have actually people in this fellowship who ask their bosses, plead, beg, can I just get off on Sunday morning? I don't want to work on Sunday morning so I can go to church. I'm a Christian. I want to go to church on Sunday morning. Nope, can't do it. Sorry. I'll come in on Sunday afternoon, Sunday night. I'll work any of the other 6 days a week. Nope, we need you Sunday morning. And of course, then you get the memo from corporate. Make sure all the employees know we do not say Merry Christmas. We don't want to offend anybody. Keep it to Happy Holidays or Season's Greetings. Quite a change. And I certainly don't have to give examples of how the culture has changed, do I? We're in a post-Christian culture in our country. And that's why reading Paul's experiences here is so beneficial. Because here's a man ministering in a non-Christian culture. And you notice it's not just simply his evangelism plan of, let's find a way to invite him to church. No. But that's what passes for most evangelism in a lot of churches. Just find a way to get them to church. Then the preacher will get them saved. Really? People don't want to come to church on Sunday morning. But most people like to talk. And Paul engaged people right where they were, in the marketplace, on the street corner. Just the people he knew, the people he came in contact with. And that's what the Lord would have for us. Engage them. Engage them where they're at. Paul was bringing in the current people that they knew and the writers that they read. Engaging the culture, but bringing Christ to the forefront. Because the message that Paul shared in those days is the same message that we have today. And the need is just the same today. That we are sinners who have offended the holy, righteous God. But he has provided a way that we might be saved and forgiven of our sins by sending his son to die on the cross for us. And after that death, rising from the grave to show indeed that that death was accepted by God in our place, and that we are now forgiven of all of our sins. I said earlier that you didn't want to come to the goddess empty-handed, but that's the only way you can come to Jesus Christ. Just empty your pockets, drop your hand. Don't think, well, God, I'm coming to you with my church attendance. I'm coming to you with my check that I write to the church. I'm coming to you with my hymns that I've memorized and my Bible verses. My good works, God. I'm a good person. Don't bring any of that stuff. You come empty-handed to the Lord, and you say, I've got nothing to offer you, Lord, and I just fall upon your mercy that's found in Jesus Christ, and he'll accept you. He accepted me. He accepted many of the men and women that are sitting around you today. See, to a neutral observer, Christianity should not seem to be a threat. Why would it be? What's wrong with Christianity? At least if they're going to follow the teachings of their Savior, they're going to be honest people. That's good. They're going to be hard-working people. They're going to be people who love their kids and love their spouse. I mean, if we do what the book says, why would anyone have a problem with Christianity? And yet so many people have a problem with Christians, don't they? You know why? One word. Agenda. They've got an agenda. Demetrius and these silversmiths, they had an agenda, didn't they? That's why they didn't like the Christians. It was costing them some bucks. And there are people in our world today who have an agenda for money, an agenda for power, an agenda for sin. And to them, Christians are a threat. Because we say, I fear no man. I bow to no man. I only bow to my Lord and Savior. And I will not fear what man can do to me, even to the death. I will fear no one but God. That's why Christianity has to actually be outlawed in so many countries of our world. Because those rulers, who enjoy freedom from themselves, by the way, know that if the freedom of the gospel spreads throughout their country, they're going to lose their power. Just like the British lost their power over the colonists at the founding of our country. Because faith leads to courage. Our question, those of you who are believers in Jesus Christ, and if you're not, I hope you become one before you leave this room. Just pray in your heart, trust Jesus before you walk away. But our question is, Lord, we are in this spot on the globe. We are living here in this time. What would you have for us, Lord? How can we serve you? How can we walk worthy of our salvation? Use us, change us, so we can go and be an instrument of change for you, Lord, in this fallen world that needs you so much. That should be our prayer.